In this video, we're going to be making a new scribble pad for this Neve 5315 broadcast board from the 70s. Today's video is sponsored by PCBWay. New members get 10 free boards using their $5 voucher when they register on the site for the first time. Link below.
My name is Eric Strebel. I'm an industrial designer. Welcome to my channel about product design and making. I hope that you like, enjoy, and become a subscriber.
So what is a scribble pad? Well, they put these things on these broadcast boards so that you can track what the different channels are and write notes about them. This one happens to be broken. You can barely see it there, but on this one shot, you can definitely see it's cracked in half and I've super glued it back together. So the first thing we need to do to reproduce this thing is to clean it, because ultimately we're gonna scan it and I need to get a really good scan. And this thing has been around for 30 plus years in who knows what kind of an environment, probably where people were smoking and spilled all kinds of coffee on the board and who knows what else. I don't have an 11 by 17 scanner, so I'm gonna have to scan this in two parts. Now, originally these boards were broadcast boards used for TV and that sort of thing, but they've been converted into music boards, and because they're made by Neve, they're popular, and so they're worth restoring. So we'll scan this thing, we'll flip it over, and we'll scan the other end. Nice high resolution, and then we'll place them together at the correct scale inside of Affinity Photo. I think the first time I scanned this busted unit, maybe at 300, but I ended up going back and rescanning it at over 1000 DPI just to get the resolution and so I could get really good detail on the numbers. So the one, pretty easy to make that. It's a square box and around the corners, and Affinity Photo lets me do that pretty easy. So remember, this piece was made in the 70s. It's probably almost 50 years old. It was made when there were no computers. It was made with an end mill, probably with some sort of an engraving machine by hand. So I have to duplicate this style digitally.
Make sure you give the video a thumbs up and then you hit the bell. Hit the bell again so you get the little parentheses around it. That way you'll be notified every time I have a new video.
So the first laser cuts and engraves were done on some Bristol boards so I could test the scale and the spacing of the letters and stuff. Ultimately, we're going to do it on laminate. And as you can see here, the first laminate test shows that the numbers are a bit heavy and we want to match the original as close as we can. And that's not good enough. So we need to change that. All right. Affinity Photo does not have an offset tool built into it like Affinity Designer does. So I use my Lightburn software and I do an offset, probably an 0.2 millimeter offset on the numbers. And then I pull that data back into Affinity Photo and make my adjustments from there. And that's what I'm doing right here, basically thinning out the numbers and making adjustments. Just much better to do with a good vector tool like that. And I'm sure there's other tools out there, whatever. This is what I own. I think Affinity Designer may be on my list very soon as I'm ditching all of my Adobe products as I hate their business model. It's horrible. A quick note about the laminate we're using a laminate made by Wilson Art. Obviously, I couldn't get the original laminate, so I had to do a fair amount of digging to match the gloss level and the color level of the original, and that took some doing too. So when I cut these on the laser, I put down a piece of packing tape, and this packing tape just gets burned through by the laser, but it basically collects the soot from the laser cut and makes it very easy for me to clean the laminate. Basically, I don't have to clean the laminate. I can just pull off the tape and not have to use any acetone or anything like that. And all the grime just stays stuck right onto the packing tape and it makes it easier. Some people use that transfer tape. I just don't happen to have any transfer tape and I found that this packing tape works really well for this. Some of you are going to say that the laminate is not safe to cut on the laser machine. I don't have any issues. I'm really not cutting a lot here, and I'm not cutting through the material. It worked quite well. Your mileage may vary here. All right, let's take a look at what we got. We'll pull the tape off and we'll reveal the part. Tape comes right off and you can see that extra soot around the engraves where the laser was engraving the numbers on the passes. I think the whole piece probably took a good 15-20 minutes to cut out. And here we're going to bandsaw it to size. I found this was going to be the easiest, quickest, just to make one of these was to sort of cut really close. And this is why I cut the outline of the part so that I could trim it out by hand and then finish it on the sander since we're just doing the one. I did think about cutting all the way through. I didn't know how good or clean of a cut that was going to get me, and ultimately I knew I needed to clean it up. So we're basically just going to sand to the line, and we use the belt sander here. Sand it as close as I can or as I feel comfortable, and then we'll end up finishing it by hand. All right. We're trying to make something straight, flat, and smooth. And of course, you know what that means. Always, always use a sanding block. So here I just make something very quick on a sanding stick, something that I can hold in my hand and I can control, and I can really watch myself sand and get really close to the dimension that I want. Do various grits of sanding paper. The red was probably a 120 or a 180. This is probably a 220, something like this. I doubt I even went to a 320. All right, it's important here to have some good form. Make sure that you are going the entire length of the laminate so that you get a nice, flat, straight edge, which we need in this case. Pay close attention. Try to keep your sanding block square to your piece so that you're not rounding anything over and you're taking your time. To further make sure that I get a straight piece, I'm going to run this on the edge of a file. This tool is normally used for my clay modeling tools to sharpen my spring steel tools. And I'll show you that really quick. This is normally how we sharpen them to get a nice square edge on them, but in this case, it's going to work really well for my laminate part. Sand down the ends as well to make those nice and flat and square so we get a piece that looks decent and will fit onto the production board where it's supposed to go correctly. All right, we're going to use a pair of calipers so we can measure the original and the new piece. The strange thing about this whole thing is while it was built in the UK, all the dimensions are in inches. This was back in the early days before they converted over, and they still haven't converted over, so this thing is an inch and a half wide. I am slightly over on the thickness, but better to be over than to be under in this case, since we want it to fit really well and we can always take off a little bit. All right, let's go over to Vintage King and test it out. And here we are testing it in the place where it has to go, kind of dimly lit. And it's super close and a little bit of handwork is needed. I do go and sand down the edges just a hair to make sure that it fits into the channel before it gets laminated in there with some contact cement.
So there you go. That's how you reproduce an old vintage scribble pad for a Neve 5315.
Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. You can do that by clicking on the icon in the bottom right of the video or below the video. Give it a thumbs up and follow the channel there as well.
Hey, and don't forget to follow me on social media. I'm on Facebook sometimes, Twitter usually, and now Instagram. Rock on.
Click here to check out some of the other design and making videos that I have that you might enjoy.